Hey there! Have you ever worked on machinery that breaks down for no reason? Tired of working on engineering exams that seem to have no solution? Well, fear not! The Amazing Master Tool Corporation, a subsidiary of Flyby Night Industries, has asked who? Me! To show you the handiest and dandiest engineering tool you'll ever see! And don't you wanna know how it works? First, you take an everyday, easy problem, bang your head until you give up. Then reach for the tool that's not a slicer, it's not a dicer, it's not a chopper or a hopper. What the heck could it possibly be? It's Gremlin Begone! At Gremlin Begone, we understand how difficult it is to take responsibility for your actions. That's why our motto is, The Gremlin Did It! With one spray of our patented formula that in no way causes sterility, Gremlin Begone will solve any problem. Does it work on machinery?
Hey, what the heck?
It works on machinery! Does it work on those pesky exams?
Hey, you better knock that off!
You betcha! Well, don't take our word for it. Just listen to our victim. Did I say victims? I meant satisfied customers.
Where am I?
Get your bottle of Gremlin Begone for 3 easy payments of $140.23. Act now and we'll throw in another bottle for free.
Use Gremlin Begone in a highly ventilated area. Do not use Gremlin Begone if you're a pregnant, intelligent, or a living creature. Side effects related to Gremlin Begone are hot sweats, cold sweats, trouble eating, trouble breathing, night terrors, day terrors, mutations that may or may not give you superpowers, but will most likely result in spontaneous combustion.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to this exciting world of CAM programming and CNC. This is the last video in our 6-part journey together, and I gotta say, I'm gonna miss you guys.
I'm not.
Silence, you. Well, I am. We come so far on our adventure together. I know when picking your course-required classes that you have zero choices, so I'm glad you picked me to be your guide. Now let's get to it. Today we will be learning how to set up the CNC lathe.
Or as I like to call it, the automatic spinny cutter doohickey.
Uh-huh. Well, let's head over to the lathe and show you how to set it up. Unlike the mills, the lathe has a USB port next to the emergency stop for your convenience. Insert your flash drive, and just like the mills, copy your G-code to the main page. Be sure that your program name and comment are listed at the top of your G-code.
Take a look at the snapshot of the monitors we have in the lab! Each one has markings over the top of the certain tabs on PathPilot. This is because we do not need to make any changes under these tabs. To alleviate your curiosity, let's take a look at what they do and why they do not need to be adjusted. The Settings tab allows you to change the lathe options depending upon its configuration. For instance, in the top right menu, you can see that the turret is selected. This is because inside the lathe, an 8-tool turret is mounted to the table, as opposed to a manual changer. The lists on the left side of the screen are active G-code. If you look at the main page, scroll down and see the G-code, you will see some highlighted G-code. These are the active G-code settings. For quick reference, the active G-code is listed under status. Next, let's take a look at our offsets tab. When you manually change tools in the mill, each tool must be measured each time you use that mill. With the turret, however, the offsets are preset. Using this offset tab, all of the lathe tools always stay in the same position. So there is no need to change the offsets unless a new tool is inserted or the tool wears. The conversational tab is how you can machine on the fly without programming on a CAM software. This can get quite complex, and you are generally better off just to program it in Fusion. The Status tab shows you a list of actions and errors. If a program fails when you hit Cycle Start, it will be listed here.
Let's head back to the main page and set up our G30,
which is your machine home position.
The G30 is important on the CNC lathe because of the tool stick out on the turret. When the turret changes tools, the X and Z will go to this position. This is why it is important that the G30 is set further than your longest tool. For this class, we will bring the X and Z to the furthest point. Then bring both axes in the opposite direction roughly 1 inch and click set G30. Now no matter where I'm at on the machine, if I press go to G30, it will return to that spot. The stock we set in Fusion is a half an inch, so we will need a piece of half inch 6061 aluminum round stock. The final part length is 1.42 inches long. Let's call it an inch and a half. We will add a half an inch to the back of the part to keep any tools away from the chuck, and an additional 3 inches in the chuck to grab onto. This means that we need a total stock size of at least 5 inches. There's also a rubber stopper in the back of the machine, roughly 16 inches to the chuck jaws, because without it, the lathe will leak like a sieve onto the floor. You do not want to cut your material too long and push the stopper out of the back. For this job, we will need a cut of stock between 5 and 18 inches. This piece is 11 and a quarter, so we can use this piece of material. You want to plan out how to set up the lathe before getting onto a machine. One thing to not overlook is the amount of stock that will be sticking out of the chuck. Tool deflection occurs when you either stick your material out of the chuck too far or you're trying to cut too deep on a single pass. A good rule of thumb is to not exceed the stick out past 3 times the diameter of the stock size. Tool deflection will cause the material to push off in the opposite direction of the cutting force. This could cause cuts to leave a taper along the length of your final product. The final piece could be narrower near the chuck and wider further away. We exceed the 3 times rule slightly because of the nature of the part we intend to cut. We set up the tool paths to compensate for this by going back over the finishing pass and thread operations.
On most manual machines and larger CNC lathes, we use a tailstock to hold the far end in place and minimize the amount of tool deflection.
Okay, back to the stock. Insert your stock into the chuck and slightly tighten it using the chuck key. Never, ever, 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 ever leave the chuck key in the chuck. In fact, never let go of the chuck key when it's inside the chuck. This is as true for CNC as it is for manual machines. If the machine is turned on with a chuck key in the chuck, it can be extremely dangerous. So don't do it. Ever. That being said, tighten down the chuck until you feel friction on the stock while you rotate it. You should be able to slide the material in and out of the chuck with little slop. Set your dial calipers to 2 inches and tighten down the lock screw. Use the depth gauge end of the dial calipers to obtain an offset of 2 inches on your material stickout. Now finish tightening your stock pretty frickin' tight. Yeah. You don't have to worry about over-tightening the chuck, so really wrench down on it. If you do not get the chuck tight enough, the material could spin inside of the chuck. Now let's zero our Z-axis. We only have to zero one tool, and only on the Z-axis. How cool is that? That is provided that the machine tools or offsets weren't changed. You should be able to set your materials, zero your Z, and just send it. You will still want a feed hold prior to cutting the material after each new tool change to verify your Z offset, just in case. Let's make sure that we're at G30 and we rotate the turret so that we are at tool 2, which is the main tool we'll be using for facing and roughing. Now visually look at the turret to make sure that when it rotates, it will not collide with anything. In order to switch the tools, you would need to close the door to deactivate the safety switch.
Under your G code window is a typable, insertable, a place where you can type stuff in. This is the MDI, which stands for Manual Data Input. This is where you can give the machine one line of code to complete. This is also where you change tools in the turret manually. To switch the turret to tool 2, type in T, followed by the desired number. In this case, type in T2 and hit enter. The turret will rotate counterclockwise and then lock clockwise. Verify that the tool 2 is in line with your stock, and using the hand wheel spinny thing, bring the tool close to your workpiece.
Some stock, after it's been cut, will have a little piece of material left behind known as a pip. Don't ask me what pip stands for. Believe me, I have looked for the definition. I believe that the last machinist to know that information passed away in 1972. So that info is gone forever. Anywho, you'll want to avoid this altogether or cut it off because it will offset your Z. When you come onto the Z, you want to avoid this pip, so you could simply just raise your X up a little bit to hit the material. To set our Z, we will be using this, a 1/1000th inch shim that goes between the tool and the material. Set the step function to 1/1000th or 0.001. Hold the shim in your left hand, and with the inner wheel, bring your Z closer to your stock. Move the shim up and down as you step the Z-axis close to your material. When you get close, move one step at a time until the shim is stuck. Don't go any further, or you can move the tool position. Once set, simply click on zero to zero your G54. Now carefully move the Z-axis back away from the material and remove the shim. Once away from the stock, about an inch or so, click on go to G30. Make sure the coolant nozzles are all screwed in tight and pointing at the cutting edge of the tools. We will be using tools 2, 4, 6, and 8, so adjust those accordingly. Press cycle start, feed hold it prior to cutting the part, and verify visually that you're about as far off of the material as it says in Path Pilot. Once satisfied, hit cycle start again and watch the machine do your bidding. Remember to keep your finger on the feed hold button so that you can pause the machine in case something happens you didn't intend. Darn it, Gremlin, how'd you screw this up?
You caught me.
Get out of my machine.
No, not Gremlin Begone. Not again.
Oh, sorry, guys. Let me explain what happened while I was filming this. As you can see on Path Pilot, the tool is about to collide with my workpiece. On approach, the tool should be roughly 0.03 on the other side of the Z-axis. I was able to stop it in time because I always keep my finger on the feed hold while running the first part. This is what went wrong and how I fixed it. That operation was profile finishing, so I went back to Fusion to see what the Gremlin did to it. I wanted to bring up the tool for profile finishing. When I looked at the post-processor, I noticed that the turret was set to 1 instead of 0. Now, I don't expect you guys to know this.
So why are you telling them then? Goodbye.
I'm telling you this for one reason. You must pay attention when running one of these machines to avoid crashing them. I was able to feed hold the machine before something bad happened. The 440 mil I trained you guys on is pretty weak at forgiving if you crash it. The bigger machines can quite literally tear themselves apart. Thank you.
Well, that was fun. After fixing the turret option in the tool library, I ran the simulation again to double-check my toolpaths. I should mention that because that option was connected to the post-processor, it would not change the simulation, which is why I didn't catch it before. After running this simulation, I posted the new code on a flash drive and overwrote my existing code on PathPilot. The change I made starts after profile roughing, so I do not need to run that operation again. So what I can do is scroll down my G-code and find the first profile finishing operation. Right-click in the empty space above it and select Set Start Line. This will start the machine from this line of code. You want to make sure that the tool is away from the material to give the spindle enough distance to ramp up. Okay, let's hit cycle start and finish the part. I will still feed hold prior to cutting to check my offsets.
There we go, that's better. It is especially important with your threading tool to feed hold it, because once it starts cutting threads, the feed hold button becomes inactive. If you were able to feed hold during this operation, the thread tool would most likely break. If you need to stop the machine, you could hit stop on PathPilot or the emergency stop. When the part is complete, the machine will return to its G30 position. Wait for it to finish before opening the door, or it will stop the code before it has a chance to go to the beginning. One of the best things about CNCs is that once they are set up, you can easily cut a duplicate part. If you want to cut another part without setting the Z, simply close the door and type in T2Z0X0 in the MDI text block and hit enter. Make sure you get your code right when doing this so that you don't end up crashing the machine. Then keep your finger on feed hold just in case it doesn't stop. Raise the X slightly to avoid any pips and adjust your stock to touch the tool and then tighten the chuck. Once again, leaving your fingers on the chuck key. Yeah. So back the Z off, and then you can just hit cycle start. The machine will return to G30, and it will continue cutting the next part. When the part is finished, make 1,200 more, and bam, you're well on your way to becoming a machinist. Apprentice. That's it, ladies and germs. I hope to see you in the lab for some hands-on experience. The gremlin won't be there. I don't want to burst your bubble, but he doesn't exist.
Is that a fact? So then why do you always blame me every time you screw up?
Bye. And good luck to all of you, bright young engineering students.